With fresh unemployment stats out this week, the government says it is committed to getting more people off benefits and into work. Louise Upston is the new Minister for Social Development and Employment. Congratulations on your appointment and welcome to Q&A.
Thanks, Jack. It's great to be here.
Give us your vision. What do you want to achieve as the Social Development Minister?
So I'm really clearly focused on supporting job seekers into work. Unfortunately, the report that we've seen this week, particularly for young people, if someone goes on to welfare under the age of 20, this recent report has said on average they will spend 24 years on welfare. I've been a solo mum on the DPB for a period of time, and it was really the toughest time of my life. And so I want to see more New Zealanders connected with the opportunities of work, and particularly those who are currently on the job seeker benefit, because what we do know, when people are in work, they are better off, not just economically, but socially. Social connections, better health, better mental health. And so that is absolutely my priority one, is supporting more people off the job seeker benefit and into work.
Let's look at the numbers then. So according to the latest stats for the quarter ending December, 109,000 people are on the work-ready job seeker benefit. So what will that number be under your government?
Yes, so first of all, I actually focus on the total job seeker numbers. And I do that because although there's two categories, there's work-ready and there's health condition and disability, those on health conditions and disabilities, the intention is that they'd be ready for work in 2 years. Mm. And I think it's really important that the team at Work and Income start working with them now, so that they are ready, so that they are providing training opportunities, and they are building the skills and capabilities so that they are ready to be in work in the future.
So the total job seeker numbers, to take your measure, are at about 190,000 right now. What will they be under your government?
So first of all, the increases won't be what the previous government allowed to happen. 20,000 in the last year alone.
Let's talk about your government. What will you achieve? 190,000 at the moment? What should it be?
Absolutely.
Under your government?
So I will have a target. You're probably aware, Jack, that the government at the moment is working on what will be a series of measures that we can demonstrate to New Zealand that we are delivering as
when
a country.
When will you have that target?
It'll be pretty soon, actually. I'm already doing work on it. And there's so the first thing is to stop the massive increases that we've seen under Labor's watch. We are facing some challenging economic times. So Treasury's forecast is that that number will keep going up until January next year, peaking at just under 200,000. So I want to make sure that number is coming down. And so we'll set a target.
We'll see what the target is.
We will set a target, and that won't be far off.
So one of the ways you've said you'll assist people into work is through the reintroduction of the 90-day trial periods for employers.
Yes.
What evidence does your government have that those trial periods will help people on benefits transition into work?
Yeah, so what we do know is a lot of people who are on welfare currently on the job seeker benefit, they have what I call lumps and bumps. There might be some challenges that have kept them out of the workforce for a period of time. Let's face it, if you haven't had a job for 2 years or more, it will be challenging for you to reconnect. And I want to make sure that employers are willing to give someone a chance.
Right.
If I think about my time as Minister of Corrections, we got 2,000 former prisoners into work. And it's that balance of making sure employers are willing to take a chance on someone. And for some businesses, that 90-day trial was sufficient barrier.
Yeah.
So not having that barrier, I think, is useful.
So what evidence do you have that those 90-day trial periods are actually an effective way of getting people from benefits into work?
Well, because we do know, if you look at the groups that are overrepresented on welfare stats, they tend to be women, they tend to be Māori, prisoners, as I've talked about.
Doesn't answer the question, though. What evidence do you have that the 90-day trial periods are an effective way of doing that?
Any employer that I have spoken to recently who talks about the fact that is one of the issues that stops them from taking on staff. And if on top of
just employer feedback is the evidence you're basing that on?
That's what I'm referring to.
Right, so under the previous National Government, Treasury commissioned a detailed report on the 90-day trial periods. Have you read that research?
I haven't, no.
I went through it. Page 5, quote, this is under the previous National Government.
Yep.
We find no evidence that the 90-day trial policy increased the probability that a new hire by a firm was a beneficiary or job seeker beneficiary.
Yeah, So Treasury provides advice all the time, as government agencies do.
What did the authors of that report get wrong?
Well, at the end of the day, ministers make decisions, and I'm really clear, my priority is to support job seekers into work.
This is a report about those trial periods
from when
National was last in government.
Yep.
You haven't even read it, but the authors say that your point is fundamentally wrong.
Yeah, so there's not one thing that is going to support us getting those numbers down. 190,000 New Zealanders on the job seeker benefit. They're missing out on the opportunities and choices that work brings.
There's no one thing. I think everyone would agree
with
that.
There's no one thing.
But the report commissioned under the previous National government that had a similar policy in place said that this one thing is totally ineffective.
Well,
now, another thing you're going to introduce...
I think time will tell on that. And as I say, I am relentlessly focused on how we support people into work. One of the things that I'll be doing, Jack, is also focusing on businesses and employers. I've already met with the Auckland Chamber of Commerce, for example. We're really keen to work together on how we can support particularly small businesses, and that's where that 90-day trial affects them.
So don't you think
to
you
work
have
with employers? Look, there's as a new minister, 2 months in, there's masses of reports. That's not one that I have read. Yep, absolutely, I get that. I'm really clear about the social outcomes report that has come out just this week that says 24 years for a young person on welfare, that is not something
I think is acceptable. No, yep. I don't think anyone's disputing that.
Great.
So another way that you're going to help to bring people from receiving benefits into work is with a new sanctions system. It's a traffic light system for sanctions. So you've got your green light, your orange light, your red light. Will the number of people sanctioned by your government increase or decrease compared to the previous one?
So let's just explain for people what sanctions are. So there is a mutual obligation for someone receiving welfare to do their bit. So for someone on a job seeker, it might be having an up-to-date CV, participating in training, applying for jobs, going to a job
interview. You've got to make an effort.
Absolutely.
We all understand that. So will the number of people sanctioned, beneficiaries sanctioned, increase or decrease under your
government? I would expect it will increase. It's a consequence of people not taking actions to help themselves.
And we should note that it's significantly decreased under the previous government relative to the previous National government.
50%.
Yeah. So what evidence do you have that sanctions are an effective way of getting people into work?
Yeah, so exactly that. So we now have 190,000 people on the job seeker benefit, 67,000 more than 6 years ago. And if we look at the use of sanctions or consequences for people not taking the steps they need to take to find work, that's 50% more.
You've read the report from the Welfare Expert Advisory Group?
Yes.
Quote, there is little evidence in support of using obligations and sanctions to change behaviour. Rather, there's research indicating they compound social harm and disconnectedness. What did that report get wrong?
Yeah, so there's a range of research, and I acknowledge that.
What did they get wrong about that?
Well, as I say, there's a range of views around consequences.
So what was wrong about that line from the Welfare Expert Advisory Group?
I'm not saying it's wrong. There's a range of views.
So you agree with them that there's little evidence in support of sanctions?
There's a range of views. They have one view. My view is very clear.
You said you agree with that line.
My view, Jack, is very clear. We have seen an absolute blowing out of welfare dependency under the watch of Carmel Cipollone and the Labor government. I don't think that's good enough. And I want to make sure, so the traffic light policy that you have referred to isn't just about sanctions. Part of having a system like that is to look at what is the risk that someone is going to be longer term on welfare.
So
it's also about what additional support do they need.
So what happens if someone gets the red light?
Yep.
The worst scenario, they have their benefits suspended. What happens to them?
Yeah, so there's a graduated series of sanctions.
Yeah, if they're on the red light, they're absolutely at the worst end. What happens to them?
So there's a graduated series. Part of the addition to the sanctions regime that we've proposed with that, there's two non-financial sanctions. So one is money management, for example, so they wouldn't get their benefit cut or reduced. That's particularly of interest to families with children. No, so the maximum is that there could be a 50% reduction.
For families with children, but for beneficiaries without children, the maximum is the maximum, right?
Yes.
So what happens if someone has their benefit totally cut?
Yeah. So
What happens to them?
What happens with many of them is they then, I think the figure is 88%, then comply with their obligations.
What about the 12%?
Well, that's a consequence. So if you think about the thousands of low-income taxpayers who are assisting to fund the welfare system, they think it's quite acceptable that people play their part to find a job. And that's common sense.
I'm just interested, if someone has their benefit card, in an absolute worst-case scenario, how would they pay to survive?
Well, there'll be a range of options.
Like what?
But the welfare system...
What are those options?
The welfare system
is mutual obligations. Yeah.
And if they are not fulfilling their obligations, then it is
options?
Quite clear about the fact that the welfare system will not support
them beyond that point. What are their options?
Well, they might go with family, they might go with friends, there might be others that look after them for community...
Family and friends, community. Except, of course, the WEAG report quote that you agreed with said there's research indicating they compound social harm and disconnectedness. So family and friends might not be an option.
Yeah,
what would be the impact on the child with the 50% sanction on a parent? What would be the impact on the child if a parent had their benefit cut by 50%?
Yeah, so that's why I've proposed two additional non-financial sanctions.
The money management, for example.
Yeah, and community
But you still have that option for a 50% cut to a parent beneficiary of the child. So I want to know, in that worst-case scenario...
Well, I'm not anticipating that will be used in the same range that it was.
But it will be used?
Yep, and it's used now.
So what happens?
And it was used under Labor.
So what happens to those children?
Well, their families, as I said, 88%, then comply with their obligations. And it's a final resort. It's a last resort. I don't want to leave the impression that that is something that happens very often. So if you look
at
those...
But it does happen, and it will happen under your government.
It does, and it's a final step.
Yeah.
Look, if you think about the working income frontline staff, they work incredibly hard to support people to do their bit. But there will be some that actually refuse to. And there should be a consequence. And
for their children as well.
That's only fair to tax-paying New Zealanders that there is a consequence.
Is it fair to their children?
Well, as a parent, I think it's really important that parents with children take their responsibility.
Is it fair to their children? Yeah.
The option is that they comply with the obligations.
Kids should choose better parents.
They're not unusual. Mm. They're not unusual, and they're not onerous obligations. Mm. And I think that's the important part of it.
Are benefit levels at their current rates enough for beneficiaries to live with dignity?
Well, it's challenging to live on a benefit at whatever rate, which is why we've committed to annual increases. But it's tough. I'm not going to pretend for a moment.
Are they enough to live with dignity, do you think, at their current levels?
Yeah, I do.
You think they are?
I do. Yeah.
Okay.
We've seen annual increases. They'll continue under our government to be increased annually.
Yes, speaking of the increases, you are changing the way that benefit increases are calculated,
are.
From indexing them to wage, from wage increases to inflation instead.
Yes.
So on the current projections, will that mean beneficiaries this term receive more or less money than they would have under the previous system?
Well, it very much depends on what happens
so
with
under
both
the current
of those.
Projections,
yeah,
on
so,
the current projections,
yeah.
what is it?
So CPI is likely to be slightly less and on... For some, it might mean, $2 a week, $1 or $2 a week. The important part CPI
just to be totally
indexing,
clear, is it will beneficiaries, under the changes you've made, receive more or less money this term on current projections than they would have under the previous system?
They're likely to get less,
right.
Marginally. Yep. So in terms of indexing, can I just explain why we index?
Please.
So 31 years of the last 35, we have indexed increases to benefits based on CPI. And that is to accurately reflect the costs that beneficiary households face.
So why do we index superannuation to wages?
Well, they're two very different things.
But why?
So
if it's good enough to index benefits to CPI, why is it okay to do superannuation to wages?
Well, CPI for beneficiaries is directly linked to the real costs that they face.
Do people traditionally, over those decades that you've cited, would they have received more money as beneficiaries if their increases had been indexed to wages or CPI?
I don't have that figure in front of me, but I do know more traditionally CPI is used, and it was interesting with the previous government, they moved from CPI to wages, and then they moved back to CPI, and then were going to decide year by year.
They moved it to wages because wages would give beneficiaries more money.
Consistency, though, I think, is really important.
Well, you're the one who's changed it, so consistency is important. So wage growth is projected by Treasury, the Reserve Bank, in the half-yearly economic update in December. Wage growth was projected to outstrip CPI. So by an analysis in the New Zealand Herald, I think beneficiaries will be more than $30 worse off every week by the end of this term, more than $50 worse off by the end of the decade than they would have been under the previous system. And that's your decision.
Yeah, and actually, I want to focus on having fewer people receiving welfare and have more people in work.
Okay,
they will have higher incomes in work and better life outcomes, not just for them, but for their children. So that's where my focus is.
There's a fundamental point, though, right? At a time when both Treasury and the Reserve Bank are forecasting a significant increase in unemployment as a result of broader economic conditions, you are cutting the increases to benefits. What does that say about your government's values?
So what I would say about our government's values is very, very clearly, we want to have fewer people on welfare. We will not tolerate people being stuck and dependent on welfare, not just for a few years, but for a few decades.
Our focus will be on supporting people off welfare so they can earn their own income. Many of the people who are going to be made unemployment during this tricky economic period may be on benefits for the first time in their lives.
Yep.
And at the time they experience that, your government has made a change, meaning they will get less money than they would have under the previous system.
And the reality of the economic times we're in is there are also households who are doing it really tough out there on low and middle incomes. So the cost of living, absolutely, is affecting Kiwis all over New Zealand. And so what we want to do is to make sure that the annual benefit increases reflect the actual costs and increases in costs that people face.
Yeah.
But my priority is to actually help people into a life of more opportunity and more choice that comes from work.
We're out of time. Thank you very much. Good luck in your portfolio, and we look forward to seeing those targets soon.
Thanks, Jack.
Louise Upston.